Hello everyone. Thanks to everyone for watching this video. My name is Qi Dang. I am an architect and engineer. Today's video is titled Unreinforced Piers, and it is going to introduce the eccentrically loaded correct piers. I am going to give you an overview of what I am covering in today's video. First at all, it is a bit of background to the topic, and then focus on the differential equation of the pier inflection and the collapse load. Eccentrically loaded masonry piers behave very differently from reinforced concrete columns. In masonry piers, cracking spreads diffusely throughout wide areas of the structure, and the nonlinear effects are much more served. They strongly reduce the pier's strength. Even small eccentricities of the axial loads can produce serious reductions in strength. Now we see this figure. The point load C is located at the edge of the core, such as E equal to T over 6. In this case, the neutral axis skirts the lower edge of the section. The stresses exhibit the triangular distribution shown in the figure. For the rectangular section, we know that the core width equals T over 3. Elastic flexural deformations must be taken into account in the analysis of an eccentrically loaded pier. Such deformations increase the axial load eccentricity and narrow the resistant areas of the pier sections as shown in the new figure. With gradually increasing axial load intensity, this effect becomes more and more relevant and the pier may collapse. The right-hand side figure shows the effect of the flexural deformation and the cracked distribution in a masonry pier of height h, with transverse rectangular sections of dimensions b times t, eccentrically loaded at its end sections. This analysis refers to the pier's compressed edge. In fact, it is simpler to refer to this edge, rather than to the pier central axis, which continuously changes position inside the resistant sections during loading. The end sections of the pier are assumed to be hinged. The constraining effects of flaws present at the head and base of piers or building walls, as well as the presence of flying buttresses and buttresses in cathedral piers, justify this assumption. In this analysis, the reference parameter is the distance u between the compressed edge and the axis of load p. Owing to the lateral inflection, this distance varies along the height of the pier. The axial load p is applied at its end sections with eccentricity e. In the right-hand side figure, the distance of the axial load p from the generic edge of the pier section is indicated by u, while UL and UO are the same distances but to the end and the midsection of the pier respectively. Thus, we have UL equal to half of T minus E. This strong eccentricity condition loading corresponds to positions of the point load of P at the pier end sections included between the edges of the section and its core. The axial load narrows all the resistant sections of the pier. We need to evaluate the changes in the resistant sections areas along the height of the pier due to its inflection. The straight line defining the direction of load P, represented by a dotted line in this figure, passes at distance u from the compressed edge at any section of the pier. As shown in the figure, distance u gradually decreases from the end to the midsection. The maximum distance, UL, is reached at the end sections of the pier. The minimum UO at the midsection. The stresses have a triangular distribution at each transverse section of the pier. Compression vanishes at the crack tip. On the opposite side, the compression shows here. In this equation, sigma OU is the local maximum stress in the section whose compressed edge is at distance U from the P axis. The maximum compression stress of all the local maximum stress, sigma OU, indicated by sigma maximum, occurs at the pier midsection, at a distance half of h from the end sections and equals this expression. Now we see a simple figure. It shows the deformation of the pier's compressed edge. The origin of the reference axis is at the midsection. Axis x is parallel to the direction of p. and the tangent show to the deformed compressed edge at the origin O. Now let y be the distance between the line of the Piers compressed edges from axis x. Thus, at each section of the pier, we have y equal to u minus uo, and for x equal to half of h, y is equal to ul minus uo. Now we see a figure of curvature of the compressed edge. It shows a small element of the pier between the external edge and the boundary of the cracked zone. The distance between the unloaded and the compressed edges of the element equals 3 times u. The length of the element from the unloaded side is dl, whereas the length of the compressed edge is dl minus epsilon times dl, with epsilon the strength in the external compressed edge of the element. A relative rotation phi occurs between the side sections of this element. The strength epsilon in the external compressed edge can be evaluated according to the local maximum stress as this expression, where E is the elastic modulus of the masonry. This rotation phi can be obtained as this equation. The length of the compressed side of the element equal to dl times 1 minus epsilon can be expressed in terms of the radius of curvature rho of the curved compressed edge as rho times phi equal to dl times 1 minus epsilon. After simplification, we obtain this equation. Because the curvature of the function is y equal to ux minus uo, then we can get the second order differential equation of y. Strengths epsilon are very small, so that dy over dx is negligible with respect to unity. Thus, we can assume this relationship. Then the second derivative can be expressed as this equation. In order to integrate this differential equation, we must consider the two boundary conditions. At x equal to half of h, y is ul minus uo. At x equal to 0, y is 0. Satisfying the two boundary conditions, the integration is obtained as this equation, where alpha equal to uo over ul. Know that the eccentricity e is given by half of t minus ul. The integration expresses the relation between the flexure factor alpha and the eccentric axial load p. Let us now define a reference critical load as shown here, which is evaluated by means of the moment of inertia i.e. of the resistance section of the pier head. This section has height 3ul. The moment of inertia i.e. is thus given by this expression. Taking these equations into account, we obtain this expression. This equation holds for half of t larger than e equal or larger than t over 6, where e is the load eccentricity at the end pier sections. This figure gives a dimensionless representation of function p over PEQ by assuming eccentricity e equal to t over 6. In this figure, starting at p equal to 0, load p increases, while bending factor alpha equal to uo over ul decreases. The first branch of the equilibrium state describes this behavior for alpha varying from alpha equal to 1 to alpha equal to 0.6115, just where p attains its maximum. All the points belonging to this branch represent a stable equilibrium state. At the point defined by alpha equal to 0.6115, the axial load equals P over PEQ equal to 0.285, which is the maximum load that the pier can sustain. Any further increment of P will now lead to collapse of the pier by loss of equilibrium. In particular, when the point load at the head section is located at the edge of the core section, with 3ul equal to T, the entire section is resistant, and load PEQ matches the Euler load PE. So we obtain this equation, where I is the second moment of inertia. Now the collapse of the pier loaded axially with higher eccentricity will come about under the axial load as shown here. Alternatively, highlighting the dependence of the critical load on the eccentricity E at the end sections of the pier, we have this equation. When the load is applied at the core edge of the end sections, we obtain PCR over PE equal to 0.285. For larger eccentricities, the reduction in the critical load with respect to the ola load is greater. For E equal to half of T, the critical load vanishes altogether. From conclusions, what we learned, a pier in architecture is an upright support for a structure such as an arch or bridge. In masonry piers, cracking spreads throughout wide areas of the structure. Even small eccentricities of the axial loads can produce serious reductions in strength. Okay, thanks to everyone for watching my video today, and I do hope you found the video informative and that you learned some things from it. If you do have any questions, then you can write comments and messages. I am happy to answer any questions. Thanks for your watching.